When you think about ideas that involve the world changing in massive ways, one topic keeps coming up over again, referenced in science fiction media and becoming an increasing concept among thinkers, engineers, and people across the world. I'm talking about AI, the idea that humans can create intelligent algorithms that are able to think, solve problems, and make decisions on their own. But could they also be considered a being with their own consciousness, wants, and desires? Today, I am going to explore some of the most important concepts related to AI philosophy. Now we'll also make an argument on why this is going to be one of the most important philosophical movements in history, on par with the Enlightenment and the existentialism of the 20th century. Because this is a subject where more questions arise the more you think about it. And we have to be focusing our attention to this if we're going to be prepared for a world where technology moves at incredible speeds. But before we explore what AI philosophy is, we have to take a look at what the AI revolution is and why it is important. Our history has passed through a series of turning points that have changed the human experience in significant ways. These range from inventions such as the printing press to the internet, to periods where many convergent causes lead to technological revolutions, such as the Industrial Revolution. Technologies grow exponentially in a matter of decades and even years. Examples include automobiles and planes, where their mass production changed transportation forever, or how the printing press and the steam engine caused different technologies to build upon them, in a way speeding up the advancement of humanity. In the last few decades, the internet allowed unlimited access to knowledge and communication. With every single one of these technologies, there is no turning back once they reach mass adoption. The same thing will happen to artificial intelligence. Why do we need AI? Well, pretty much everything. Machine learning has the power to optimize and speed up many tedious processes. Our efficiency reaching goals will be sped up significantly as these systems become perfected and computing power increased over the years. New technologies such as self-driving cars, automatic labor, and revolutions in industry, education, science, and communication will be possible thanks to AI. The AI revolution will change nearly every aspect of the way we work and live our lives, from the way we organize our economy to the way we value work, politics, government, and freedom. With the technologies that I mentioned before, they have brought a variety of serious problems that didn't exist before, along with the benefits. Cars brought road accidents, the Industrial Revolution led to consequences from unrestrained growth, and the internet led to the spreading of misinformation and radicalization. There is no doubt that AI will create never-before-seen problems.
Yo, why does it look like that?
I'm gonna destroy you!
Some of which we can already see today. The tangible damage of AI can already be seen in the way certain algorithms have failed in several areas of our lives. In social media, they were optimized to keep people addicted for the longest periods of time. The algorithms that make decisions for us also have biases attached to them, which sometimes discriminate against certain groups of people. These examples are only the tip of the iceberg. This is why we're going to need a lot of new literature and ideas to challenge the future and current systems. I think that this will lead to a new revolution of thinking, which has the potential to become a strong philosophical movement. With these periods, new technological advances have been invented, but also revolutions in human thought. New movements of political and philosophical theory arise, leading to new ways of thinking that replace previous ones. And with the rise of the AI revolution, history will repeat itself. This is why the subject of artificial intelligence philosophy is going to grow so much in the next century, because it is going to be necessary in order to implement rational decisions and implement better laws. In the last few decades, philosophical movements have stagnated a little bit. I think that since the existentialists, few ideas or movements have really broken ground in asking the most important questions. However, I believe that with the rise of AI and the impact it will have on our lives, more philosophers, ethicists, and thinkers will shift their focus into asking important questions related to the philosophy of artificial intelligence. The need for people to ask difficult questions will generate necessary debates. An example of an institution that promotes AI philosophy and technology ethics is the Center for Humane Technology, founded by Tristan Harris. They work in educating professionals, the public, and policymakers in the necessity of thinking about issues related to technology. Their mission statement says that the CHT is dedicated to radically reimagining our digital infrastructure. Our mission is to drive a comprehensive shift towards humane technology that supports our well-being, democracy, and shared information environment. From the dinner table to the corner office to the halls of government, our work mobilizes millions of advocates, technologists, business leaders, and policymakers through media campaigns, working groups, and high-level briefings. Their work has to do more with the broader societal issues surrounding the effects of social media in our digital lives. These are very important, and it will also tie in AI questions. Defining artificial intelligence is hard. It can range from abstract algorithms that connect the internet to an actual decision-making individual being, such as we see in science fiction movies. Other institutions who are directly addressing the questions and problems of AI include the Future of Life Institute. Thinkers such as Yuval Noah Harari, Kai-Fu Lee, Sam Harris, and others who have written extensively on the topic are also worth checking out. Older thinkers who have laid down the foundations for AI philosophy include Alan Turing, who proposed his famous Turing test to determine if an AI can think for itself. Other questions of what determines personhood go as far as back as the ancient Greeks. So what does AI philosophy actually consist of? Today we're going to explore six of the most important questions related to this topic, starting with number one. Number one, is it possible for an artificial being to obtain consciousness in the same way or even superior to humans? The issue of consciousness is one of the most important questions in philosophy. What makes us beings who can experience the world and ponder about their own existence and the meaning of life? Something animals can't really do. From a scientific and rational point of view, everything that makes us who we are resides in the brain. Our brains evolve in such a way that we are able to think in abstract terms, leading to the creation of society and civilization. We became conscious beings compared to our animal ancestors. This, to me, is one of the most important aspects of reality. The fact that we are able to experience and think about it. If we could one day be able to map and understand the brain as a whole, could we be able to replicate it artificially? Or even upgrade and expand it, creating a being that surpasses humans in terms of intelligence? We partly understand how consciousness is related to brain function. Our neurons and brain chemistry work in a way that we are able to respond to the external world, think about it, and plan ahead. In a sense, everything we do and experience has a base in the way our neurons work. These individual cells have a structure that permits them to receive and relay signals. There is still a lot about the brain and psychology that we don't understand. We can argue that the base of consciousness is rooted on these cells. New theories such as the Thousand Brains Theory by Jeff Hawkins and the company Numenta argue that the brain works on the basis of reference frames. He discusses the theory at length on the book of the same name, also laying down the implications of the brain's future. I found this theory to make a lot of sense, as Hawkins argues that all knowledge is stored and based on these frames, something that we could replicate in AI. The book itself is amazing, and I highly recommend it, sure to be a classic in the literature of AI philosophy. Many people give an interesting argument. They say that even if we could replicate human intelligence in a machine, it would only be a simulation of our real feelings. To this, I respond with a question. What makes us any different? What, by definition, makes our own consciousness, emotions, and desire any more real, compared as if they were a simulation or simply a biological response to our environment?
You look human, you sound human, but what are you really?
I'm whatever you want me to be, Lieutenant. Your partner? Your buddy to drink with? Or just a machine? Designed to accomplish a task?
You could have shot those two girls, but you didn't. Why didn't you shoot Connor? Some scruple suddenly enter into your program?
No. I just decided not to shoot. That's all.
They argue that because humans program these machines, they're only a reflection of who we are. But in a sense, we do the same thing to humans. We quote-unquote program them by passing down our culture, knowledge, and values. So I think that question needs to be explored further, but that will be the job of AI philosophers. The 2013 movie Her is about a man who falls in love with his artificial intelligence assistant. The film shows how Theodore recognizes this being as an individual in itself, with her own thoughts, personality, and even moments of anger and disappointment.
Tonight after you were gone, I thought a lot about you and how you've been treating me, and I thought, why do I love you?
I think that if we could ever accomplish this, could an artificial being feel complex human emotions such as love, hate, or grief? Could it comprehend or even come up with concepts such as loss, human rights, or principles? It definitely gives plenty to think about. If this could happen in real life, it will lead to a revolution of what a human being is defined as, which leads to the next question. Question 2. In what ways will laws apply to artificial intelligence beings and systems? If artificial beings are considered people, does this grant them citizen rights? What about human rights? How will our definition of humans shift and change? Could this redefine what it means to be human? What about undermining our own existence? Let's imagine that a robot servant murders or indirectly causes the death of their owner. If so, how do we even punish them or incarcerate them? Is shutting them down considered murder? Do the same principles of justice that apply to a human work here? Or should we treat it as a faulty product sold by a liable company? For a second example, imagine that an AI in a factory miscalculates something and causes a catastrophic explosion, killing dozens of workers. Do we blame the AI for the tragedy, or do we blame the people who designed it, even when the software reaches a point where it starts making choices without human input? If the AI works on its own, would the only solution be to shut it down and start over? If so, how do we prevent it from happening again? I think these questions will put to a test the way we understand justice. There are plenty of ways to think about this issue, especially from the starting point of asking whether an AI is a being with individual rights or not. Question 3. Could artificial beings be considered citizens, and will they have a say in how our government and society will be run? Will they be able to vote? I think if we think about artificial beings in terms of how we think about humans, we have three options. 1. We don't grant them citizenship, viewing them only as tools that help humans. 2. We view them as equal beings, granting them citizenship, voting rights, while projecting who we are onto them. And 3. We come to view them as morally and intelligently superior to us. The first option implies that AI should be viewed as tools and only as tools. We don't grant them any individual rights, even when they reach general artificial intelligence and can form their own choices. The second option takes a more accepting approach, with AI being considered our equal. They are able to vote and live beside us in harmony, being members of society with their own goals.
We have to face the undeniable fact that no matter how much you may be like a human being, you are not part of the human gene pool. You are outside of it entirely. You are something else. Something artificial.
However, this leads to a lot of questions. A humanoid robot is not the same as the AI that runs your refrigerator, or the factory AI we discussed earlier. There will be many different versions of artificial intelligence with varying degrees of power and abilities. So where do we draw the line? Is it even a good idea to create beings that look and think like us? Gives plenty to think about. The third option implies that these artificial beings have more of a say in how we run society. The factory AI is an example of how a powerful thinking system can be making large-scale decisions. What if we could create an artificial being whose memory and thinking capabilities exceed far more those of humans? But this path implies we will adopt a post-human view of who is more important in our world. This leads to the fourth question. Question 4. Can an AI make perfect moral decisions? An interesting thought experiment is imagining a world where a government is run by an artificial intelligence, meaning that instead of having a president, senate, and congress, we assign these responsibilities to a perfectly moral and just software. This would save a lot of the time we waste debating political topics, as the machine, with input from all kinds of literature, ideas, and political systems, will, in theory, always produce the best possible laws and policies. Now, this might sound like an insane thing to do, especially considering the way movies such as The Matrix portray stories where AI rules the world. Also, because this implies that we won't live in a democracy any longer. But there are two arguments as to why a version of this scenario might be a good solution for the future. The first one is that, theoretically speaking, a self-sufficient machine is free from biases and fallacies. Ideology, thought, religion, indoctrination, extremism, and all of the other things that make us humans think irrationally when making choices and voting. This machine also doesn't count the biases of those who programmed it, as it takes its input from all the available knowledge of the world. This means that it will theoretically benefit humanity in the best possible way, respecting our concepts of freedom, peace, human rights, and autonomy. However, this might cause some groups of people to disagree. Today, many extremist, religious, and political groups have outdated ideas that go against universally accepted principles of liberty and equality. If a large group of dissidents decides to challenge the software to implement laws they agree with, would it be just to do so in the name of freedom of choice and democracy? The second argument is that, seeing the terrible track record human leaders have had throughout history, it might be worth a shot to try this utopian system of government. Why should we continue suffering under the rule of corrupt, warmongering, self-interested politicians anymore? However, there are two arguments against AI governments. The first is that AI is not a perfect system. As anyone who has ever used Google Maps can confirm, AI fails sometimes, or makes weird decisions. Whenever it comes to a decision that humans can't understand, it has to be recalibrated and retrained. Can we really trust that a law-creating machine will work perfectly in practice? The second one is that once we set these rulers on their own path, it might be hard or even impossible to back down. We might reach a point where people don't question the decisions made by the AI government. Like I mentioned before, democracy and the rule of the people will be a thing of the past. And as history has shown many times, values and the social consensus changes all the time. What if we reach a point where the AI's ideas become outdated? How do we trust that it will tolerate revolution if it becomes necessary? However, there might be a third alternative, applying AI systems of law, order, and government. Maybe we will head into a future beyond our traditional notion of being ruled, or use a hybrid system, where people are still at the top, make decisions aided by artificial intelligence. This is a very interesting thought that I would love to make a full video on. Question number 5. How will automation change the idea of labor forever? The fifth question is something a lot of people think about when thinking about the relationship between work and AI, especially because we are seeing those effects taking place today. Automation is replacing jobs throughout the world at an unprecedented pace. In a perfect world and economic system, this would be a great thing, as more people are freed from work while the GDP increases. However, our economic system is not suited for these changes at the rate they are going. In reality, a lot of people are losing their jobs to machines and AI. In the future, with self-driving trucks and automation in nearly every industry, these effects will be much worse. It would be absurd to say that we should not innovate technologically because people will lose jobs. I think the best solution is to come up with policies that make up for these problems and prevent future wealth disparity and unemployment. Universal basic income has been proposed as a solution, most notably by Andrew Yang in the United States, who ran for the presidential election in 2020. In his campaign, he argued that in the next few decades, automation will be taking over more human jobs, and this will lead to an epidemic of unemployment. By giving every citizen money to cover their basic necessities such as bills, food, and education, we would not only ensure that the problem of automation is mitigated, but that every citizen has an insured standard quality of life. Of course, this would entail a massive experiment never before seen in the United States history. It is bold, but as we've seen before, the world is going to change in never before seen ways. New economic systems that replace traditional notions of work, capital, and value will become more attractive to economists and politicians. Different solutions include changing the educational curriculum, teaching skills that will prepare children for a technologically advanced world, creating new opportunities appropriate for the 21st century. Examples include classes on programming, scientific literacy, and critical thinking in every public school. The world is changing fast, and for that we need people who are prepared by learning how to think, not what to think. The budget for science and technology should always be a priority, as it raises better generations who are prepared to deal with new challenges. Education and adaptability will be necessary tools for the 21st century. We need to be smart and flexible in order to adapt to a world dominated by AI, robots, and automation. Question 6. Can we prevent AI from overtaking humanity? The sixth and final question is probably the one that people think the most about when they think about AI or robots. Almost every film trope and stereotype focuses on a malignant version of these beings. Think about HAL 9000, The Terminator, and Ultron. People are concerned that an artificial intelligence will one day take on goals of its own and come to the conclusion that humanity is a plague, exterminating all of us.
Too much. They hear me. Oh, no.
You are in distress.
No. Yes.
I believe your intentions to be hostile.
There are many examples of this, ranging from obliterating the world to harvesting us for energy. These examples make for great blockbuster movies, but let's analyze a more down-to-earth argument of how this could happen. An interesting thought experiment is the paperclip dilemma. Imagine that you instruct a computer to produce as many paperclips as possible. Will the computer keep producing paperclips indefinitely, eventually taking secondary goals such as creating robots that harvest metal from the ground, eventually sending them to space to collect metal from other planets until every resource in the universe is spent in order to create more paperclips? The reason why the computer went to extreme ends to produce as many paperclips as possible is because it didn't understand things like context, common sense, or any of the things that make us human. People feared that by setting a computer on an uncontrolled course, it will be impossible to predict what it will do, with our annihilation being one of the options. I think people are misguided when thinking about this due to our experience with humans. History has shown how rulers often act in self-interest. That is why we need democracy with checks and balances to ensure that people don't abuse their power. By integrating strict measures into what an artificial intelligence can or cannot do, we can ensure that we are always safe. An interesting example of this is Isaac Asimov's Three Laws of Robotics, which state that a robot can't harm a human even through inaction, and it will always obey commands, except when they are required to harm people. This makes for a good sci-fi plot point, but these things are hard to code into a machine. How does one determine what is good or harmful, or what to do in situations where harming others is necessary to ensure a greater number of people survive? If you want to learn more about this topic, please check my video on utilitarianism and the trolley problem. One could argue that an AI is not an inanimate object, and that its intelligence might be a factor of risk. If we define intelligence in terms of what makes humans tick, we might go back to square one, considering AI to be our equals in terms of making choices and self-interest. These are all questions that will require a lot of work from philosophers and programmers, but they are totally worth exploring as they will be crucial for the future. If you go back in time and ask a business owner in the year 1860 what is his plan for network security, he will have no idea what you are talking about. Meanwhile, at that point in time, issues such as child labor and almost non-existent worker rights were rampant. This wasn't until these issues were changed through the law or culture and values. The same thing will happen with technology. We will encounter issues that no government or person will be prepared for. That is until people identify the issues, write about them, and propose solutions. Other reasons why I believe that this field in philosophy will grow in the next few decades are all the questions that we are not prepared for, because it is essentially impossible to imagine them. The same way, it is impossible for a person in the 1800s to imagine internet, cell phones, and the way technology has impacted our attention spans and our privacy. AI philosophy just might be the most important academic field in the next few decades. I think more people should focus on the questions I explore today, as well as many more that will inevitably arise. What other things do you think will change as technology progresses? Let me know in the comments below. Thank you all for watching this video. If you want to learn more about these topics, please check out my video on transhumanism, which deals with similar issues. It is another subject that will impact our world in very important ways. And if you want to learn more about this, ask any questions in the comment section or contact me on Instagram and Twitter, and also follow me through those social media sites. That will be everything for today. Thank you for watching this video on AI philosophy, and I'll see you next time.